saying our deepest condolences to the Aragon family for your loss. Amen. I would like for us to all stand right now in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just want to lift you up today, Father. Father, we thank you for Mike and Ann and all they brought to the family's life, Lord God. Father, the memories, Father, that will live on from generation to generation, Lord Jesus. Father, we ask you, Holy Spirit, to comfort the Aragon family, Lord God. Comfort them, Lord Jesus. Spiritually, financially, and physically, Lord God. Continue just abiding with them through this time of need, Lord God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence in this place. And we give you all the glory in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. There's a scripture that's very familiar to us in this time. And it's found in the book of Psalms, Psalms 23. And it's written by a young shepherd who later on becomes a king, as we know of King David. And the young man writes here, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. And for his name's sake, amen. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy. My cup overflows. You anoint my head with oil. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Right now we're going to have Elias, the grandson, come up and say a few words. Amen.
Hello, everybody. I'm Elias Zoya. I'm the oldest grandson of my grandmother. And I'm honored to be able to speak upon my grandma, Aunt Patricia Aragon, and just talk about her life to her siblings as a sister, a mother, a wife. She was the baby of 11, with her having 5 older sisters and 5 older brothers. Her parents were Elias and Josephine Sandoval. She was born October 24th, 1961, right here at St. Anthony's Hospital in Denver, Colorado. Now, her being born and raised here in Colorado, she attended Columbian Elementary, Skinner Middle School, and ended at North High School. And North High School is where she also started her first job. And for those of you who may have met her back then, she first worked at the Federal Theater. Shortly while she was working at the Federal Theater, she had her only daughter, or only blood daughter, my mom, Desiree Sandoval. Some years later after that, she attended Levon's Beauty Cosmetology School, and this is where she accomplished the biggest thing in her life, I would say, and that's where she went on to cut hair for the next 30 years plus with the same one company that she was devoted to, Great Clips. In those 30 years, she also met her husband, Mike Aragon. In 1995 is when they were married, and that is also where she took the mother figure of 4 more wonderful children, also becoming a grandma to 8 grandkids, 3 more wonderful children, one thing, and also becoming a grandma to 8 grandkids and 2 great grandkids later in the years. In her life, she was always a caring, compassionate, goofy, crazy, loving, and of course, the fighter that you all knew. She was very resilient and independent. There are so many traits that I'm sure we feel about this beautiful woman, and I want you guys to hold on to those. Make sure you Remember how she was to you, and not just what I'm saying, who she was to you as a person. My personal relationship I had with her was, that was my grandma. Used to call her my Nana Banana. And there's just a couple stories I would like to share about her that are always gonna be with me. There's a couple kids that she used to watch for the last 10 years. And, there was this one time we all had went swimming together, and she was sitting there in maybe about 6-inch water, and this rec center had the little tidal waves that would go on every few minutes. And in this 6 inches of water, she was sitting there rolling over and over, and she couldn't get up. And we sat there laughing at her because we didn't think that it was serious, because it was, the water was maybe this high. And she was just sitting there spinning, and she sounded like she was drowning. And even the lifeguard just started staring at her, confused. And it was one of the funniest moments we've ever had. The other thing that I would like to share about her is me and her can never go anywhere together. We could never take anything seriously together. We used to go to bingo a lot, me, her, and my mom. And we would sit there, and me and her would just be laughing at each other for no reason. There was nothing that was funny. And then we would stop laughing, and they'd end up looking at each other and just start cracking up again. And everyone else around us would be getting so mad. They'd be shushing at us and telling us to be quiet because they're trying to hear the bingo guy call the balls. And that was just showing the type of person that she was. She didn't have a care in the world about how other people felt towards her. It was always her own perspective of everything. And I think that's all I got right now. Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The memories and the laughters, the times together, those are always powerful. Amen. It's something that doesn't erase from our minds. You know what I mean? I'm going to ask Felix, the nephew, to come on up and share a few words also. Praise the Lord.
Elias, that was beautiful. Thank you. Good morning. On behalf of my family, I would like to begin by thanking everyone that is here today and for those who have sent their condolences, thoughts, and prayers. They have been both comforting during this time. Most of you know me, but just in case, my name is Felix. I'm Mike's nephew. However, we always considered ourselves as brothers. I was honored when I was asked to present Mike's eulogy. I had the opportunity and the privilege to grow up with Mike and live with him. Michael, Monica, Matthias, and Desiree, please accept my condolences on the loss of your father and mother. Mike was an uncle and brother to me. I loved him greatly, and I will forever miss him. Really difficult, but we'll get through it. Michael Joseph Aragon was born October 30th, 1959 in Denver, Colorado. He was called home on December 9th, 2021. Mike was a husband, father, brother, grandfather, great-grandfather, uncle, and a true friend. He was married to Ann Aragon until she was called home November 26th, 2021. Together they helped raise their children, were blessed with grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Mike worked hard for everything he had and lived a remarkable life, which he dedicated to loving his family. He enjoyed life, family gatherings, holidays, and most of all, super hot chili. And he always had said, it's gotta be that dynamite. Mike is preceded in death by his beloved wife, Ann Aragon, his mother, Mary Aragon, brother, Jesse Aragon, his sisters, Inez, Josie, and my mother, Gloria. Mike is survived by his son, Michael, Matthias, and daughters, Monica and Desiree, his grandchildren and great-grandchildren, as well as his brother, Joseph, John, and sister, Linda, and many beloved nieces and nephews. There's so many stories and memories I'd like to share, but if I did that, I'd be up here all day. So I'd like to share a poem I came across the other day as I was preparing his eulogy. And there were so many different poems that I would like, but this one kind of reached out to me. God saw you getting tired, and the cure was not to be. So he wrapped his arms around you and whispered, "Come unto me." You didn't deserve what you went through, so he gave you needed rest. God's garden must be awesome now. He only takes the best. So when I saw you sleeping so peacefully and free from pain, I could not wish you to come back to suffer all that again. Rest in peace, my uncle and brother. Thank you.
And now we're going to hear a song entitled, "So Much in Love."
Good job. Thank you.
God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, and none shall perish, but all come into everlasting life. What a beautiful song. Right now we're going to have the niece Vanessa come up and share some special words.
She was funny, caring, selfless, and one of the easiest to talk to. Talking to my auntie was easy because you knew, no matter what the conversation was, that she was there to listen, to give advice, and would never judge you on anything that you were telling her. I'm going to miss our inappropriate jokes. My aunt was also known for her cooking. Her cooking became better as I became older, or I was just a picky eater. As a kid, I remember throwing my food behind the stove at my aunt's when she babysat for us, just so that I could go outside and play with my cousins. My favorite food of hers was her sweet rice. She was a tough woman. She spoke her mind. She would do whatever she could to help and take care of the people that she loved. My auntie loved to cut hair and style hair. She was awesome at it. I had the honor of knowing, loving, and being loved by my Aunt Tiani, and for that I'm thankful. We love and miss both you and Uncle Mike until we meet again. Thank you, guys.
Praise the Lord. And now there's going to play a popular song, "Por Ti." Amen.
Hello, my name is RJ. Shorty and I have been the closest friends since 1985. It was her niece Linda who introduced us to one another. Shorty was my maid of honor at my wedding. She baptized my daughter Marie. My daughter was her flower girl in her wedding. Compared to giving birth to my daughters, this will be the most difficult thing I have to do in life. How do you tell your best friend goodbye? Well, I'm not saying goodbye because she will always be here in my heart. We will never part. I'm gonna share her with God. There is a hole in my heart that will never close. I will have to learn to live with it. Shorty would have wanted it that way. She was a very strong lady with a great sense of humor. And that is what I want to share with all of you. No tears, just laughter. She is smiling down on us as I speak. So when our daughter Desiree and Brandy were young, we took them to see the Parade of Lights in downtown Denver. We caught a bus and walked the rest of the way. We walked by the convention center. There was a slanted concrete wall. I ran up the wall and down it, no problem, with my long legs. While Shorty ran up the wall, no problem. But on her way down, Shorty hollered, "Wonder Woman!" She ran so hard and fast, her momentum made her fall and tumble as she fell. We laughed so hard, Shorty and I still laugh at that story 30 years later, as if it happened yesterday. April Fool's was one of her favorite days, from putting Priscilla's kitchen furniture in her living room and her living room furniture in her kitchen. Shorty enjoyed saran wrap. She would put on toilet seats when anyone went to the restroom. Well, it didn't go in. She loved to laugh. That's when she was at her best. Learning to laugh at yourself was part of being with her. I would speak to her every morning on my way to work. So till we speak again, so long, my friend.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of our Aragon family, I would like to thank each of you for being here today. Also, I'd like to thank Pastor Ray, Pastor Ed, and Pastor Robert for your time. For those that don't know me, my name is Joyce, and I'd like to say that I'm the favorite niece of all my uncles and my aunts. Today, we are putting my Uncle Mike and Aunt Anne to rest. It's very hard to lose a parent, but to each of the children that not only have to say goodbye to their mom, they also have to say goodbye to their dad. So to Desiree, Michael, Monica, and Matthias, my deepest condolences go out to you. I don't have very detailed, specific memories of my uncle, but I do have to say that he did throw the best 4th of July backyard barbecues that anyone can throw. I'm just gonna move on. This is hard. So I have a poem for both of them. For I have gone home now, you can release me and let me go. For I have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to me with tears. Be happy that we had so many years together. I gave each of you my unconditional love, and you can only guess how much you gave me and happiness. I thank you for the love each of you have shown, but now it's time that I travel alone. So grieve a while for me, if you must. Then let your grief be comforted with God's enduring love. It's only for a while that we must be apart, so cherish each of my memories that I have left behind. I won't be far away as life goes on for you and the daily hustle and bustle consume your time. Know that I won't be far from you. Though you can't see or touch me, I'll be near. And if you listen with your heart, you'll hear all my love around you, soft and clear. And then when you must come this way, I will be there to greet you with a smile to welcome you home.
Right now we're going to look at the screens on the wall, and we're going to have a memorial video slide there of all the memories of Monica.
She threw her arms around him. only imagine what my eyes will see when the fact is before me. I can only imagine.
Thank you. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne
to all the family. A very difficult hour. I know that one of the most difficult things you can do in your life is say goodbye to someone you love so dearly. And in this case, it is even more so that way based on the fact that you lost both Mike and Ann almost at the same time. We're celebrating their lives today. But I'd like to say to the family members that we've been in prayer for you. And we believe that God will give you the grace, the peace, the comfort that only come from Him. The Bible tells us that He would be our ever-present help in the time of our trouble. He says, I will never leave you or forsake you. For Mike and Ann today, they need not our prayers any longer. They're in the hands of God. Their trials, their toils, their difficulties, all the things they've gone through, that is over. They've finished the race. They're in the hands of the Lord. You and I still continue to go on. And you as a family, you feel the loss. The Bible says that there is a time to weep, a time to mourn. God understands your tears. He knows what you're going through. You've lost your family member, your father, your mother, your grandfather, your grandmother, your great-grandparents, your sibling, your friend. It's not easy. No one says it is. But we do know one thing for sure, and that is that the Bible says God will always be there for us in our time of trouble. So in behalf of our senior pastor, Pastor Ray and Lola Chavez, who could not be here today, we would like to share those condolences with you that we believe God will continue to be with you in a special, special way. I want to take just a few moments to share something with you that I believe is so important in this last day. You heard the songs being played while the video was going on. One of them entitled, If I Can Only Imagine. I can only imagine what heaven's like. We have a lot of different beliefs in the time in which we live. It's said that we have thousands upon thousands of different religions in the world today. Someone told me it was over 100,000 religions. That means that that many people believe something completely different than everyone else. But the important thing to know is this: it's not about religion. It's not about this church or any other church. Church won't save you. Religion won't save you. There's only one that died on the cross. Pastor Robert shared that scripture in the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 3 and verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Amen.
Only Jesus paid the price. We've just celebrated Christmas, celebrating his birth. In a few more months, should the Lord tarry, we will celebrate Easter, or the Resurrection Sunday, when we will celebrate his death and resurrection from the cross and from the grave. He's the only one that paid the price. He has every right to request of us that we return to him what he gave to us. God understands your tears today because he lost his son. The Bible records and says that on the day that Jesus died, that when he gave up the ghost, and he said, "It is finished," at that very moment, the earth turned black for 3 hours. Some have said that took place because God, who is the light of the world, turned his back on his own son, Jesus, because he was carrying the sins of the whole world, your sins and mine. He understood that his son was paying the ultimate price. So today, very quickly, if I may, I just want to share with you what the Bible says about life. In the book of Psalms, the 103rd Psalm, there's a verse there in verse 15. I'm going to read it. It says these words: "As for man," speaking about mankind, in other words, "as for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so it flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more." In other words, what he's saying here, the psalmist, is that life is short. Mike and Ann's life, it was cut short. 60 years of age, that's still relatively young. A tragedy. It's not easy for the family to accept that. But our life is short. We don't know about tomorrow. Tomorrow is not promised. As the scripture says here, it's like a blade of grass that grows and then it withers. The wind comes across it, blows it away, and no one even remembers where it was at. That's your life. That's my life. The important thing is what we do before we leave here. There is, contrary to some belief, there is a place called heaven. And there is a place called hell. And the Bible tells us that every one of us will have to stand before God. We see, we all have an appointment with death. The Bible says it is appointed once for all men to die, and after this, judgment. So without giving you a long, drawn out sermon on life and death, I would just like to say to you this. Jesus gave us the provision to make it to heaven. He gave us the way. In fact, he said, I am the way, I am truth, I am life. So today, you have the opportunity to make a decision, and you will make that decision to either accept him into your life as your personal savior or reject him as your prerogative, because we were born what is called free moral agents to make our own decisions. But we will stand before God. Mike and Ann have already made their final trip. And you and I are here today to make our decision whether or not we want Christ in our life or not. Whether we want to accept what he made, did on the cross. You see, God's not asking for anything that cannot be done. All he's asking for is a life for a life. He gave his son on a cross to die for us. But thank God he resurrected from the dead on the third day. And through that resurrection, he gave you and I the opportunity to, when we leave this earth, we can go to be with him. The scripture reads and says that when the day comes that Jesus will return to the earth with a shout of the archangel, a trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them, and so shall we be with the Lord forever. I know you don't understand it, neither do I. I've never disappeared before. I don't understand how it's going to happen. But I believe that the Bible records that it will. And because of that, I want to be ready. So I want to leave with this. Will you make that decision today?
Yes.
Ask the Lord to be Lord and Savior of your life. The Bible, Jesus said these words to a man named Nicodemus who asked, how can I be born again? Jesus said, you must be born again. He said, how can I do that? Nicodemus asked, how can I do that? Jesus said, you were born of flesh, but you must be born of spirit and water. In Romans chapter 10, verse 9, he says that if we confess him with our mouth, the Lord Jesus, and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we shall be saved. That's all it takes. So today I pray that you'll make that decision to ask Christ into your life, to bring him into your eternity, so that you can be assured that one day you can make heaven your home. I would love to see you come to church with us here, but this is not what it's about. It's not about a religion. It's not about a church. Church is important, but it's a relationship with the Lord. That's what's important. So as we pray for this family today, in closing, I want to pray for you that God will help you make the decision of all decisions, and that's to accept Christ into your life, asking him to become Lord and Savior of your life. I'm going to ask you to do something with me right now, if you will. Just bow your head there where you are. I want to pray for each of you that you will make that decision to ask Christ into your life. And then I want to close this prayer praying for this precious family who have lost not one, but both of your parents both of your siblings, both of your grandparents, both of your great-grandparents, both of your family members and friends. Pray with me this prayer, would you? Dear Jesus,
dear Jesus,
I come before you now recognizing I am a sinner. I thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross for sinners. And today I ask you to come into my life. Become my Lord and Savior. I give you who I am from this moment forward. Asking you, Lord, to forgive all that I've done that has been against your word. And redeem me for that day when you come to receive your own to yourself. I ask you this in Jesus' name. And I thank you for the privilege of coming to know you, because you are the Lord and Savior of my life. Lord, I pray for this family, that you, O God, will minister to them in the days to come, the weeks, the months that will come, the loneliness that they'll feel, the things that they'll need. I pray that you'll supply every need for them, spiritually, physically, emotionally, and even financially. Bless them, O God, and help them. They'll need you in the next few days and weeks and months. Minister to them, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, and wrap your arms of love around them. For we love them today. We ask you all these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I want to thank each one of you for coming to join this precious family in their time of need. Thank you so much for your concern. I know you love them. I know that Mike and Ann in some way impacted your life. You had a time with them and you were impacted by them. Continue to hold on to that memory, and in that memory, they continue to live in your life. I'd like to say to the family once again, we thank you for allowing us to be a part of this service with you and share the love of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We pray, that today you may have God's peace upon you as you go from this place. There's going to be a reception held immediately after this service at the VFW Hall, found at 4747 West Colfax Avenue. Here in Denver. You're all invited to be a part of that, and you'll be able to share with them at that time your condolences and spend some time with them. So we'd like to ask you to stand, if you will, if everyone would be standing. I'm going to ask both families, if they will, to today, to as they depart from this sanctuary, you can visit with them in the foyer, or you can go straight to the VFW Hall and say your condolences there. I'd like to just ask them if they will use this aisle here, and if you will exit the church, then everyone can follow you out this morning, this afternoon. God bless you all, and thank you for coming. Family, you are